Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending on where you are on this tumultuous fast-forward planet, which is full of anxiety and losses, but also hope and creativity and people trying to communicate to make the world a better place day by day. I'm Andy Revkin, Earth Institute at Columbia University. I'm running an emergent program in communication and sustainability. The whole idea is, how do you make information matter, you know, in different contexts, in pursuit of resilience and fewer regrets and more inclusive progress. And I'm excited today to have several guests on, two of whom have been with me before, well, three actually. And we're discussing readiness. The one thing that's so clear about the situation we're in now is we weren't remotely ready. And as I said in the prelude to this online, I was saying, you know, for years, this pandemic threat has been there. It's been listed on all the global threat analyses, just like earthquake threats are listed in cities, just like conflict possibilities are there all the time. And yet we have what I've been calling since like 2008, a blah, 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 bang approach to discourse and information. And the first two people you hear from here today, Jeff Schlegelmilch and Judith Matloff, have been dug in on these issues of how do you kind of do better? And it's also do the best you can to mitigate risk ahead of time, but also be ready so that you can respond and then recover in ways that are not just building more risk as well. Jeff, it's great that you have a book out with a very apt title, Rethinking Readiness. And that's what's prompted the title of this show today. Again, we've had an epic fail. So I think, I would assume both of you would agree that the world has not gotten this right. We could get it a lot less wrong, let's put it that way. So Jeff, if we could start with you, you're now directing the National Center for Disaster Preparedness here at Columbia. You were the deputy director. You've worked in disaster management and risk for a long time. So, and I've been reading your book, but I'd love it if you had your own sense of, let's not call it an elevator talk. I think elevators are hard places to be in these days, right?
Yeah.
I haven't been in one for months, so we won't call it an elevator talk.
And if you're on one, you shouldn't be talking.
No, that's right. So Jeff, what's like your main thrust here when you think about rethinking things? Like, what does our center have to do? What do I have to do? What do we all have to do to sort of get a new approach here?
Yeah, so you know, a lot of the traditional ways of looking at disasters are to either take this scenario-based approach where you're looking at what would we do in an earthquake, what would we do in a pandemic, what would we do, and then kind of break down from there how we would do these specific responses. The other way that is preferred by a lot of emergency managers is to take this function-based approach to start looking at, you know, okay, if we have to do logistics, how do we build a good logistics system and then start to tweak that depending on the different scenarios. And they both have trade-offs to what they're doing. But I think what we're really looking at here is stepping back even further from that. What is this ecosystem of development that we're creating? How are we contributing to the underlying threats and the underlying vulnerabilities in ways that go far beyond the purview of emergency management? This gets into health equities, economic development, all sorts of decisions that can both increase the threats that we're facing as well as the vulnerability of our society to those threats. So the book kind of takes the approach of looking at these five different scenarios, bio threats, which include pandemics, climate change, critical infrastructure failure, cybersecurity, and nuclear conflict, which was actually a set that originated with my colleague, Dr. Erwin Redlener, who is the founding director of the center, and worked very closely on kind of the concept of this book. Exemplary of the kinds of disasters we face in the 21st century. But then in the second half, after presenting those scenarios, really looking at what are these common threads? What are these, what is it about the way that we develop the incentive structures that we have to develop quickly, but maybe at the expense of resilience? And how do we take a second look? Maybe we need to look at resilience further ahead, long before the disaster occurs. And how do we create systems to manage uncertainty? As we're all experiencing right now, this pandemic as all pandemics are just mired in uncertainty, and that's not going to go away anytime soon. So instead of trying to come up with that perfect tweet or perfect meme to tell you what to do, how do we build more adaptive approaches and ways for managing uncertainty rather than trying to artificially create precision that can actually take us down the wrong road and cause more harm than good? So I'll take a breath there, but in a nutshell, in a long elevator ride, speaking on the phone with nobody else on there, that's the story.
I want to show something that you said to me a long time ago on an earlier one of these programs that I thought was really important as well. And this relates a lot to what I think about in terms of communication. You said that, you know, and this is about information, like the information overload. And we all have that sense of information overload right now. But you said even for decision makers, they get stuck. As you said here, I've observed over the years, whether it's in agencies or emergency ops centers, that when we're dealing with uncertainty, rather than pivot ourselves to manage within that, as you just said, we try and cram more and more information into our brains trying to connect the dots. But that just becomes noise and actually either paralytic or can take you in the wrong direction. So have you seen evidence that, like, is there a good example of a sort of disaster risk decision-making apparatus that hasn't gotten stuck in that more information mode?
Yeah, you know, I sort of see elements of both getting stuck and not getting stuck at the same time. So I'll give an example in a lot of the public health guidance that's coming out. So I'll actually give a good example. The recommendation to wear masks is actually fairly controversial, and the science is not all that settled around it. There's not really strong, crystal clear evidence at the level that we really want that says, well, a mask provides this level of protection or a mask prevents this. There's a lot of unknowns. But we do know that in seeing various implementation strategies, there's a lot of circumstantial evidence. And that's usually not a comfortable place for scientific policymaking, but it's a consistency we're seeing across. We don't know how much masks protect you, but we do know that in a comprehensive sort of layered approach, that masks, in addition to social distancing when you can do it, in addition to better ventilation, all these other things, that with all those things combined, we do see less transmission and things like that. So that would be an example of where, rather than trying to get mired in the precision and exactly how much benefit it provides, we're able to actually say that it's a layered strategy. We know that these things all contribute to lower risk, even if we can't say exactly how much. In that same example that I just gave, there's also plenty of people out there who are saying masks can't help because I read this one study in this one place, right, or there's not enough evidence to make this recommendation. So there's a lot of sort of arguing around the edges of here, but here's one where I think that is more exemplary of that direction to go in. But every decision in the middle of a pandemic is mired by this uncertainty and mired with partial evidence that's changing all the time. And at what point do you have enough information to decide on the actions you're going to take or decide on the options you need to create to respond? And at what point is a diminishing return trying to get a more and more precise number that isn't actually going to change the recommendation?
Right. And this gets to the personal question too. I think so far we've been talking about the decision maker or the manager, the practitioner, but this is Judith's arena too, of what do you do as a person, including as an individual journalist? You've got 4 decades of journalism on front lines of one kind or another. It's not often you find a journalist whose bio is, whose definition of what they do is crisis reporting. You know, there now is the Pulitzer Center for Crisis Reporting, but you were doing this a long time ago. You know, when I think about my journalistic journey, which started mostly with climate in the 80s, it's really risk, reporting about risk. But crisis is like you're already in, I don't know if I'll use the SHIT word, but you're already deep in the stuff, you know, and how do you navigate that? And you wrote this cool book, How to Drag a Body, which is about as concrete a question as anyone should be thinking in terms of personal preparedness, you know, your own house. So in the scale of the individual, what's your latest thinking, Judith, and, you know, in the context of where we're at right now?
Well, I think as we've seen, we've had a very derelict national leadership on the federal level and in some communities as well, on the local level as well as the state level. So I think it's all the more incumbent on individuals to take as much control as they can in terms of assessing the personal risk to themselves and their families and their communities, and then to come up with a plan of action. And the thing is, if you can actually think about what could be your worst case scenario. Maybe it's both parents end up in the hospital and their teenage child cannot visit them. That would be the worst case scenario in my family, for instance. Then you think about how you would try to mitigate the risk of that happening, and also think about how that 19-year-old child would cope with the situation, as well as the other adults who he could turn to. So that's just one concrete example. But I think, you know, the thing about this pandemic is that you have crises layered on crises. You've got emotional crises, the emotional resilience question. You have the actual health emergency. Then in some communities, you have the potential of a cascading disaster situation with a natural disaster on top of it. And I think it would give each individual, and I speak from experience, having covered war zones where the mental approach to this is very, psychological approach is very similar to what people are confronting here in the pandemic. If you can come up with a plan of action for yourself and the people close to you, you will feel more in control and more prepared to handle the evolving, ongoing situation. And within that, we need to turn to the most reliable sources of information available and try to block out anything that's too contradictory to it. So, I mean, I think at this point, the CDC is probably the best we can get at this point, or look at, you know, just stay on top of the science of it. But while we're making our decisions, we want to turn to the most reliable sources of information that we have.
Yeah, and that gets back to something Jeff had said a while back here as well that I wanted to, whoops, wrong one. Let me go to it. I think it's over here. This is at the personal level. Jeff said very early on, I think you posted this on Facebook, and I said, hey, Jeff, can we get back at this? It was mainly for your friends and colleagues and close acquaintances. And you said the same thing though about the information flow, that there's a, you have to develop your own strategy for managing information. Otherwise you'll get, talk about doom scrolling is a thing. I've seen one of my sons get completely captured by it in a way that's very harmful to his state. He's kind of getting away from that now, but this was the fire hose of information is not actionable, as you say. You know, so developing that own internal capacity. It's not, or, and I do think newsrooms have some role in this too. You know, the newspaper I worked at, the New York Times for a long time, you know, it's all about the new viewer, engaging that viewer, keeping them stuck. You know, social media is all designed to grab you and keep you and pull you down. So that feels like a super skill that we all need. Judith, does that feel, is that part of what you're, you know, how to drag a body is one, and is like how to turn off another?
Yeah, I mean, I think what you want to do is identify very, very early on what you think is the most reliable source of information and keep going back to that one. I'll give you an example with natural disasters now. Emergency managers are approaching how they might handle a Category 5 hurricane or a wildfire in a different way than they would before the pandemic. So the question to ask yourself, or I'll just put it out right now, I'll give you the answer, is if you're a regular, ordinary citizen, where would you go to find out what your local emergency managers are planning? Your first point of you know, the first place you should go to would probably be your fire department. In most communities, they would be on top of it. And if they don't have the answers, then they can direct you. But don't go wildly calling the mayor's office and then calling the local hospital. The local Red Cross would also be another good source. But just keep it to those two very simple sources, and then they can layer on anything further. But you want to keep it as simple as possible with the most authoritative person.
So, Jeff, back to you in this current context. Can you describe a little bit what you do at NCDP, at the Disaster Preparedness Center? You do trainings and workshops. How many of them relate to building regional dispersed capacity to have a better interface with the public, that kind of thing?
So, I mean, I like to think to a certain extent, you know, all of them have elements of that, but it depends, right? So we have a range of courses. We have a number of training programs we're doing through FEMA right now on post-community economic recovery from disasters and post-disaster housing recovery, but then we also do a lot of community-based work. We're working with colleagues in North Carolina and Puerto Rico and elsewhere in the country to help connect the child-serving infrastructure with the emergency management infrastructure. And in all of these contexts, though, it's this combination, right? You have at the hyper-local level, at the household level, individuals who want information on what kind of actions that they can take. And there, it's usually more like a checklist, right? Like, what are the things I need in my kit? How can I, what can I do? I see the question on here, too. You know, if you have a good plan, but others do not, sort of bridging off of that, too, it's also, I mean, the whole thing is to have as many options available to as possible. That's how we manage uncertainty, is by creating options. We don't know if our neighbors are going to have what they need, but we know if our plan relies on somebody else having a good plan, we need to create an option for what if that isn't the case. But then we start to percolate that up. It's the same sort of theory, but different than practice. So at the community level, you're looking at coordination across different groups. At the federal level, you might be looking at strategic resources, but then also very coordination of very different language in terms of policy and legislative frameworks. But it all boils down to, I think really, and this is where we sort of get mired in the noise of what's going on a lot, is and what we try to do in a lot of the work we do at the center, whether it's through our research, through our trainings, through our translational research, where we're sort of taking the research and turning that into programs for communities, for individuals, for private sector organizations, is to work backwards from what is it you can do? Not what is it you're interested in, but what are the actual actions that you are able to do? And to work backwards from there, what is the information you need to help you do that, and what are the different options you need to help lead you down that path? And that helps you really down select and filter out a lot of the noise and a lot of this additional information that may be very enticing and very seductive and sort of feed into the anxiety that of everything that's going on. But ultimately, that's the ultimate question, is does it improve your ability to exercise the control that you're able to put on the situation? And if not, let it go, read the roundup. I miss the days actually of the daily newspaper, because then you can just read it in the morning, you're caught up, you go to work, you don't have, you know, the and there's something to that when information is flying this fast, is to just read that roundup and then just put it out. Probably nothing is going to happen that's going to affect most people in regards to this pandemic on that real time of a basis, that they're going to miss something if they don't read their paper, if they don't follow the news nonstop. Yeah.
And that gets back to how I think in many ways I'm worried that the news purveyors are not our friends right now. I worked at the New York Times for 20 years. I went through that transition from the daily paper to being a blogger and getting on social media. And on social media, there's so many scientists now and journalists who most of your hours in many ways are there. I guess all I'm thinking is that we need to do more signaling there too. I think, Jeff, on the program you were on at one point, I noticed, like, if you're covering the vaccine stuff, you know, which is just constant whiplash, I have this warning label. It says caution, you know, pre-review publication, that I would put in a tweet about it. So it's like literally a warning label, the orange sign that says, and I don't see that happening. I think the media have to play a role here.
And actually,
Judith, I'd love to get you teach at the journalism school. Are we just building brittle, broken readers?
Well, there is that cliche slogan, if it bleeds, it leads. And unfortunately, media tend to focus on negativity. I think one thing which is very, very challenging at the moment for any news organization is that we're all dispersed. You know, we're not, it's very, very difficult to run a news operation when people are working out of their kitchens. And I don't think it's helping, that logistical challenge is making it harder to coordinate coverage. You can't meet people in person to interview them. So much is done remotely, and that limits our ability to do reporting. But you know, I think one big challenge that media have, traditional media, is that we're competing against social media. As you mentioned, there's a lot going out on Twitter, and we're constantly having to stay on top of that in case we miss something. And that's not necessarily the fault of the media. It's just the fact of what communication is today. And you can't ignore social media if you're working for a more traditional outlet. You have to keep tracking that stuff. It's a challenge. And I do think the media, and again, the media is not a monolithic term. You know, we've got Fox, we have the New York Times, we have the Daily Beast, we have so many doing NPR. But I think it makes our job much more difficult because we can't all congregate in one place and streamline the way we do our work because we're all so dispersed.
If true. I can, sorry, I just want to add in one more piece on this. And this actually gets into part of what I talk about in the book as well, is that, so there's an incentive structure that drives the way we do things in all industries. And I think you made a great point here, which is that, you know, these media outlets are businesses, right? The impact they have is very noble. It's very important in terms of shining a light on these things, but to pay the bills and to respond to shareholders, you're looking at internet traffic to bring advertisers. And so there are incentives that are wired into the way we do things that can at times be at odds with the goals that we ascribe to these industries. Another example I talk about in the book is that with climate change, like industries that are competing on a global environment, it's in their interest to deny climate change so that they can compete in a global right. business atmosphere. And so by unwinding and looking at these incentive structures, we have a different approach, a different vocabulary for addressing these issues. So instead of it being adversarial, we can start to say, wait a minute, what is the real issue here? What is the real pain point here in getting this done? We'll probably talk a little later, but this also gets into electoral strategies and how voters right. reward elected officials. We sort of say one thing and see it as one thing, but the actual mechanics of the transactions that drive these decisions are incentivized very differently than perhaps we expect them to be.
There's some good questions coming in I'm going to get to in a second. And I see Alice Hill and Rod Schoonover are in the green room, so I'm going to invite them out, and they have to put down their M&Ms and pina coladas and come on in. And I'm not sure if you've all met. Alice Hill is a longtime, she's worked at this interface of risk and responsibility and governance for a long time. A National Security Council, she was on a bioterror planning strategy committee or team early on the Obama administration, I believe. And she's now the Council on Foreign Relations. Rod Schoonover, who's in an incredibly beautiful imaginary place, I think actually in the Carolinas somewhere, unless you're moving around, was the National Intelligence Council for years, working particularly on ecological and climate-related risk, famously resigned when the Trump administration tried to stifle ways he was going to present data at a hearing, and is a consultant in this arena and a very very welcome presence here. So how are you both doing?
Great, thank you. Glad to be here.
Good. Rod, I just want to be sure we can hear you.
Yeah, I'm doing great. I'm actually in a storage closet, so so that's why I have the great
home studios
background.
It's great to have you here. If you've been listening in, you know, we're talking about both the personal and the practitioner and governance levels of preparedness and responsiveness. There was a really good question a minute ago about, let's see, oh, it's here on screen now. Science Cathedral says people in New York City have reduced their subway ridership. They'd reduced things weeks before the mayor or Fauci told them to. And I've seen a lot of literature on this, that people are actually more responsive and logical than we think. And I think in a way the media, again, tend to highlight the outliers, the ones who are partying and doing stupid things. And that gets in the foreground. Is that masking that there is actually more responsiveness? We'll get to preparedness in a minute. Yeah, I don't know whether, Alice, you've thought about that level of this. Are people more sensible than we think they are?
Yes, I think we often see that people have done very smart things to protect themselves. We also need to be mindful of our cognitive biases. And for example, optimism in the case of climate change keeps most of us thinking that we won't be impacted by it. Right. And not until we have a terrible flood event or a heat event or something else do we really think that this could be a problem for me and my family. That's what the polling shows. So yes, there are some that are ahead of the game and are good at preparing themselves and taking the precautionary measures, but there are also many of us who just are bound by the social cognition defaults that let us get around in ordinary life. And that would be that we're optimists. It won't happen to us.
Right. And another comment that came through earlier from a professor at Doane University out in the Midwest, he said, what do you suggest if I make a good personal plan, but the others do not. This is, you know, a classic part of the landscape right now with COVID-19. Unlike climate change, unless you're thinking about voting, here's something where your personal decisions within your community can actually change the risk landscape. And you had that herd effect one way or the other. If there are outliers or super spreaders who are careless, it can kind of contaminate the whole risk portfolio. So back to Jeff and Judith briefly on that idea. Like, dragging a body is your personal capacity, Judith. But on these things that require community cohesion, are we really in trouble? And if maybe in this country particularly?
I think it depends on the community. I've been really impressed in New York City, where I'm based, how there has been incredible adherence, and that's why we've been able to flatten the curve. If I were living in a community where people were not wearing masks, I would have to factor that into my personal risk assessment. I would then think about what situations I would avoid. I would think about what people I would avoid. If that becomes my reality, then I incorporate it into my personal safety plan and my risk assessment of what dangers I would be facing. But I still argue that we still need our own personal plans, irrespective of what everybody is doing around us. And particularly with irresponsible government officials who are signaling the wrong messages, it's all the more incumbent on us to take personal responsibility to protect ourselves and our families.
Yeah, and I would just add that there's even some, there was actually a great roundup in Nature on the social behavioral sciences and what they say to help inform the response to the pandemic, and that there's a lot to be said for cultural norms. More collective cultures are more likely to have individuals making sacrifices for the well-being of others, whereas more individualistic cultures will have more trouble adapting to that. Of course, that's all made much more difficult by the inconsistent messaging we have going on in the United States right now, and the inconsistent leadership at various levels of government. That's probably putting it a bit politely. But then the other piece, as well as social norms, if you see other people in your social group behaving in a way, you're more likely to do that and to follow that lead. Fear, there was that comment on the subways as well too, you know, fear people get defensive about unless there's a clear way out of it. So if there's an action you can take, fear can be a strong motivator, but if there isn't an action you can take, it can prompt a more defensive response. But just zooming out very, very briefly, there's a lot of work that I mentioned as well in the book about how social cohesion, how connected communities are, can be a huge factor and a huge predictor, and at times an even stronger predictor of how communities fare after a disaster than investments in physical infrastructure. Now, it's not to say these other things aren't important, but just emphasizes that there are things that you can't have a ribbon cutting ceremony in front of that can actually be hugely impactful in terms of how you, your loved ones, and the surrounding community actually fare before, during, and after a disaster.
Yeah, and that we've had sessions on this before. Unfortunately, when countries or cities or communities do invest in disaster risk mitigation stuff, it usually is a thing. It's a flood wall. It's hard to build the investment argument for social cohesion. And we did a whole session on the nonprofit sector in a city. The small nonprofits, community dispersed nonprofits, are really vital to resilience, just like you were saying with the, because they know where the elderly person is on a high floor in an old tenement in an overheating building. But that isn't something that's easy to say, here's what you put money into. I do think social media, if tuned the right way, and not just social media, but WhatsApp and, you know, all kinds of things can play a big role in that. We'll see, I guess, going forward. So Rod, you know, we've talked about this a couple of months ago with Alice at the grandest scale of unpreparedness with the what I call the page 21 effect, going back to something you said,
right?
When these threat assessments, they always list pandemics, right? It's there, right? But it's like on page 21,
right?
So then it doesn't really become actionable. And Alice, you said something valuable too, related to your bioterror preparation stuff. If you don't actually run the scenario, if you don't actually go to the warehouse, if you don't actually test the system, then you could have a great scenario exercise in the White House, and that's not a plan either. So Rod, any progress in thinking about this the last couple of months since we first talked about it?
Well, you know, I just want to pick up on something that was mentioned earlier before about you know, how people in New York had started changing their public transit behavior. You know, that's probably only partially true. And, you know, as is most of these kinds of issues, there's always truth in the middle. And the middle is very difficult to game out policy-wise. And so the criticality of, and so one of the things that has really hit me, and, you know, this is a lingering issue, but it has to do with information integrity. And, you know, when I was sitting on the seventh floor of the CIA headquarters building, you know, in the run-up to the election, 2016, information integrity was a really important issue for us. I don't know how far we've gotten as a society or as a culture, but we're making, at least in terms of awareness, in terms of the importance of information integrity to social cohesion. I think some of the scrutiny to Facebook has some elements of that. But, you know, if you really have a significant breakdown in what people believe in, that in itself undermines almost all preparedness exercises or plans. And so the criticality of information integrity, you know, as a national asset, I think is unappreciated.
Well, that gets back to what Jeff has been saying about trust. You know, authorities only have trust if they are consistent. And this includes being willing to say what you don't know as well as what you do. I saw this as far back as 9/11, the dust in lower Manhattan. You know, politicians were stuck. Well, is it safe or not safe? And no one knew. And you, but again, as with masks, you kind of know some general principles, right? So Jeff, to me, over and over, and a lot of the things I write about, it still comes back to general principles. Like if a mask has multiple benefits, it's a signaling mechanism. It may or may not be perfect, but it's there's no way it's not better than not having a mask. Or maybe there is some moment when it isn't. So is there a way to look at system properties or characteristics of how we communicate that are have that fundamental value? Is that a way to go forward with what Rod was talking about?
I think so. And I think it's important to be nuanced in the way we talk about things and to be transparent about where we have stronger confidence in areas rather than others. And this is where, I mean, one of the most trusted officials right now for COVID-19, Dr. Anthony Fauci. And he's not up there saying, look, I can tell you with the exact precision. If you listen to him speak, he's being very transparent about what we know and what we don't know and why this advice is being provided and why it might change down the road. And, you know, you can't do that in, you know, 156 characters, or I think Twitter's up to 250 some now. I got to update that number so I can have a more concise soundbite. But the idea that, you know, we have to provide certainty in short bursts just is not compatible with the complexity of what we're facing. At the same time, not everyone needs to read, you know, a 15-page academic paper with 30 citations. We just need to, you know, create a culture of communication where we have a little bit of breathing room and where we're able to acknowledge what we don't know and why we're giving interim recommendations and why they might change. I do want to just touch briefly on too, because I think Rod brought up a great point in the cybersecurity section, actually, of Rethinking Readiness. Also, I mean, the nightmare scenario is not like a widespread hacker that shuts down all the electricity in the world for a year, or any of these doomsday scenarios. I mean, sure, there's, you know, I don't want to say that's not going to happen, and then it's 2020, anything can happen. But it's really, I mean, the kinds of attacks that we've seen have been to erode trust in democratic institutions. And this is incredibly insidious. It's not about changing the results of an election. It's about making people think that their votes didn't count. And you plant the seed of distrust, and then all of a sudden everything comes into question. And then you have leaders at the federal level who are sowing that distrust for electoral reasons. It creates an incredibly vulnerable environment that can be exploited with much more pervasive and cascading impacts than a single kind of malicious attack. So I think that you know, that not only do we need to get to a point where we can speak with nuance and be transparent about what we don't know, we also cannot be attacking people for being wrong when right. conditions change or otherwise kind of weaponizing the conveyance of information.
And how much of that's about the way information is conveyed? I'd have to look back at some of Fauci's statements. I know back in March, you know, he was thinking about masks in a different way because the situation was different. It was about shortages. But is this a point where you say, if you're in a position of leadership, you say, this is what I know now, and this yeah. is what I don't know now. So if your bracket, you're saying, you know, this could change, that we're in a plastic situation. If you use language like that, and in the media, I think would be the same thing. Do we have to signal, just as I said with that like warning label, that this is an incremental paper in a long journey toward a vaccine?
Yeah,
it's usually like paragraph 5 as opposed yeah. to like a meme.
Well, and even that, and it doesn't even require too much ink on the page. Like, so if I say to you, like, don't wear masks, they're not going to help you. Or if I say, you know, right now we're not encouraging people to wear masks. There's shortages in healthcare where they're much more highly needed. These conditions may change. This was the language that was on the CDC's website. It's just not the language that was being provided through other outlets. So it's, I don't think we're that far from where we need to be with that. But again, it's, but yeah, I mean, I think just in the delivery of the message and in every message, it's kind of this fallacy that we have to be certain in everything we say. And I think it becomes this, or people won't trust us, and it becomes this self-fulfilling prophecy where we end up either being afraid to speak because we're not certain enough, or we speak with more certainty than we actually have cause to speak with.
And let's talk about another category here. There's a good question from Deborah Castellino, who says she's a Columbia grad, CES grad. Madness, the eclipsing of the climate crisis, but what can we do actually to keep dealing, to keep fixing it, to be keep at it? You know, Alice and Rod, this is your arena for sure, in the sense of shaping policies that can have stickiness, even with administration changes, even with the American political landscape. Yeah, Alice, could you go back to maybe that bioterror? You told a story here early on about that arena that might be illustrative. I mean, to me, it's the continuity thing. Like, climate is a long emergency. And this, obviously, our pandemic relationship is a very long emergency going forward. So what can we do to mitigate that sort of up and down, in and out question?
Well, some of this will be, as the question gets to, will require government action. I don't think that we can expect the kinds of cuts in emissions that are needed without some global action, and that will require governments to government action. But the question assumes that there's not much an individual can do. And I think we've been talking about preparedness. For all of these events, there is an aspect of what we can do for ourselves and our families. And with climate, yes, our attempts to reduce our own emissions will not have any material impact on the global emissions. So that's more of a symbolic, an important symbolic gesture, but it's not going to change the outlook. What will change is if we investigate what impacts we are going to personally face in our communities, and then look at how we can better prepare for those. So you can look at up and down any coast in the United States, including in New York City, and we're still developing in floodplains, even though we know those floodplains will be underwater if they're in the coast for the most part. Similarly, we are continuing to develop in areas at high risk of fire. So for individuals, they can take a look at the choices they're making in terms of where they live, how they live, and can much better protect themselves against the impacts that we know will occur. One important point about climate change that sometimes gets lost in the discussion is that even if we cut our emissions to zero tomorrow, we still will face further heating simply because of the delayed effect of that atmospheric concentration of greenhouse gas emissions we will continue to experience heating for at least the next several decades. That heating will bring bigger storms, bigger wildfires, bigger everything. So we need to think through, what are we going to do to protect ourselves, our families, and our communities? Yeah. And those kinds of discussions are not happening now in a very real way. Mostly those decisions are made at the level of the local city council, and their interests may diverge from an individual's because they want to encourage a lot of development to keep the tax base up. But that development may be risky in the long term because it's in an area that will not do well under the future impacts of climate change.
Yeah, that issue comes up over and over again in my reporting. This the development imperative just bulldozes over these other things. Although I keep seeing these flashes, there are things you can do. Like Craig Fugate, former FEMA director, at a panel I was on in NYU a year or two ago. Like a century ago, basically, in COVID time. He said, I think it's just over half the states, you still, when you buy a house, you're not, the seller is not obligated to provide the flood history. He said that one thing, like just, it's like, you know, if you buy a car, actually, and it has been through a flood, we did this once, we bought a Prius that had been in a flood, and it was indicated on the registration. But you don't have that with a house. Like that feels, maybe toward the end here, we could make a bit of a list of some things you can actually see. Wow, there's a law that could do that. Or there's some way the insurance industry could recognize the value of educating customers in flood histories of properties. So I don't know, there's probably a whole landscape of tweaks like that that are sitting there waiting to reduce our exposure to inevitable events. And Jeff, I don't know, I'd be happy to work as much as we can, our little initiative with the NCDP or anyone else on making a list of things like that.
I mean, I think that there are a lot out there. And actually, Alice, when we were talking before, one of the reasons I said I was a big fan of your work is you're doing a lot to kind of illuminate what are those transactions, like what are those incentives and disincentives that are in place that provide, and I appreciate the example you just gave as well too, like an elected official on a city council is trying to improve the economic conditions of the people in the town, and you build more industry and you build more buildings, and so that's what's in kind of the calculus of that decision. And the problem is that the risk of disaster is underestimated. A colleague of mine, Jackie Ratner, and I, she led an article we have in Government Finance Review, actually looking at ESG ratings for bonds and how climate risks, one, the disclosure issues we just talked about aren't there. You're largely not required to disclose risk, but also the risks of flooding and other kinds of disasters are calculated under the E, the environmental section. And what we talk about is the social and the government impacts, the S and the Gs, are actually hugely consequential in terms of eroding tax bases, but it's underestimated. So the very transactions that are used, the yardstick that's used to say, is this a good decision or not, is actually giving bad information to the decision makers. So I think anything we can do to open that up and to make it a little less adversarial and a little more comprehensive in terms of the math that goes behind this decision making, the more likely we are to actually get to better decisions being made by better articulating the benefit to those who maybe are making decisions that aren't as informed as they could be. And we have a responsibility in academia as well too, to do a better job of building that evidence base and sort of providing more evidence for supporting those kinds of decisions.
So Judith, I want to circle back to journalism, which is where you and I mostly have lived. And there's this emerging field of solutions journalism. We actually did an episode here with Tina Rosenberg, who helped found that. And I see some evidence there that there's a way to torque how journalists think of stories, and editors even more so, toward getting ahead of the story a little bit. I was saying on here the other day in the 90s, I did a story on the future of New York City's water supply for the New York Times. And there was a point when the Metro editor, before it ran on the front page, said, "Isn't this an awful lot aren't we a little bit ahead of the news?" she said. And I was like, oh my God. That still rings in my head. Does journalism, what role does journalism play in shifting the landscape here? Is there, you know, when you think about the preparedness you wrote about in your book, you know, thinking about that and thinking about journalism as we know it feels like two very different things.
Right. Again, I want to harken back to what I said before, which is the media is not one monolithic force. And for the most part, the American public and also in other countries, we turn to very narrow silos of information. So you may be able to if you are solutions driven, you will be able to reach an audience that is receptive to that. But for instance, if you're dealing with a readership or an audience which isn't really interested in that, you can write as much as you want, but that messaging isn't going to get through. Right. And it's really, really important to talk about what form of media we're talking about, because people don't just go to one source of information and they won't look at everything out there. So one organization may be very solution oriented in its reporting, but if 85% of the others aren't, they're not going to reach people in the same way. And that's just part of the reality of the siloization of media today. But I think it is, if people are solutions driven, it can have a very important impact on how the newsroom is looking at what type of stories they should be pursuing. For instance, when I worked at the Christian Science Monitor for 5 years, they were constantly looking for good news stories, which was very challenging because at the time I was working in Africa after the Rwandan genocide. But the thing is, you know, a lot of it has to do with that particular culture of that particular media organization and its readership.
Right. So Rod, looking ahead, when you think back to the work you were doing on intelligence analysis and those conversations that would happen before that got to be a brief for a leader, is there an active conversation underway? This is also, I guess, for Alice and Jeff, maybe on re-examining those processes to be sure we can think more systemically about pandemic risk. We've had sessions here on the biological origins, on Peter Daszak has been on here talking about the, you know, getting to that root of the risk. And there's so much about the response part that we're still not getting right even now. Who's talking about the, where are we headed at the high level
right now? Well, you know, since we're in election season, a lot of that is wrapped up in partisan politics. But, you know, I've said this on your program before, but one of the things that I find somewhat disconcerting is the precipitous drop in the ability for the United States to do strategic planning and strategic foresight. And, you know, the U.S. government operates almost entirely in a reactive mode. And there are some things that you can plan for. Alice, whose comments I wholly subscribe to and agree with, there's a whole host of known risks, not unknown, known risks. Yeah. And we should be able to game those out to a very large degree at the national level, regional, community levels. The unknowns, which, you know, Jeff was mentioning Fauci's comments early on in the pandemic. This is not unexpected. This happens almost every time a novel virus or a novel infectious disease occurs. There's always misinformation or misunderstanding of what's happening. And, you know, we will be facing uncertainty. It's built into these complex systems. And so how do we build a mechanism and an apparatus that can deal with the knowns, right, the known risks, and also be able to pivot, you know, in an adaptive way to the unknowns, which also will come with climate change. And so, you know, that And people outside of government and inside of government are thinking through some of these things, but certainly not at the scale that I think is required.
I want to show something that might be a path toward a better system. This was in 2017, before where we are now. Mike Smith, who's a weather disaster, he's a meteorologist, has written about weather and disasters. He proposed that we need to make this bigger. We need the equivalent of the NTSB, the National Transportation Safety Board. We need a National Disaster Review Board so that we're analyzing things like what's happening around us right now analytically. This one will have to do it even as we're dealing with navigating it, to have a better sense of failures and have a better sense of what parts of the system didn't respond right. And sort of getting back to Alice's point about working the system, not just making the scenario. And I don't know whether that feels right. Scott Knowles, who's a historian of disaster, recently proposed something similar. I'm hoping that he can get an op-ed in the Times to make it more prominent. So do we do enough of that? The 9/11 Commission, of course, was an example.
Well, after every big event, there is some kind of investigation. After Pearl Harbor, Katrina, 9/11, and typically, most famously in 9/11, they said the commission concluded it was a failure of imagination. And some kind of iteration of that has been in most of the reports. What this proposal would do is make sure that we're systematically going back. You know, FEMA, after every event does, or every big event, typically does an after action report. The problem is following through on the recommendations from those after action reports, having the discipline to make sure it gets done. And that's what the National Transportation Safety Board has done such an amazing job with regard to aviation. With every accident, they investigate what went wrong, what could have improved the outcomes. And you can see that outcomes have greatly improved. It's very safe to fly as a result of that hard work. With the pandemic, I'm absolutely positive we're gonna have a commission or somebody that will investigate this. And I think we will be very prepared for the next pandemic. The problem is we are, as Rod said, reactive. So we will react to this, which is a huge catastrophe for the nation, and we will be much better prepared. But there are also other catastrophes right on the horizon that we are not thinking about and preparing for, which leave us as vulnerable as this pandemic has proven we are.
Yeah, and I've got all these books here.
Let's say this. Yeah.
Although at the same time, it's pretty clear that, you know, even now, if we can avoid the actual worst case, like total breakdown, even now, we've had terrible outcomes from this calamity. They're still just beginning to unfold, the economic calamity. And yet, you do see, as Alice was saying, I see potential for optimism. I don't know, maybe I'll canvas you all as we start to close here on not just your sense of optimism, pessimism, but maybe one action point. Like for Judith, in journalism, if we get back to that question of what can be done there that isn't being done that feels like a step forward. And the same thing with disaster management, Jeff, and maybe we'll start that conversation now. So Judith, your book has a lot of practical plans in it. I know I fail usually at those. When we had a big blizzard when I lived in Garrison in the country, I was melting snow on the kitchen we did have propane so we could melt snow to flush the toilets. But I always feel like I'm way behind and not doing the serious things that I need to do. And at the level of what Rod was talking about, is journalism doing enough of a look at those big parts of this question?
Well, it's funny. I was talking with some emergency managers yesterday, and we were talking about how to get messaging out now that evacuation plans have changed from what they would have been for Harvey or for Katrina because of the considerations of social distancing and the fact that emergency responders are stretched at the moment. And I think that's one area where the media, as a non-monolithic force, could be doing a better job. get out the messaging now to communities of where they would turn for information about how evacuation plans would be different now than they were last year, about whether they can cross state lines. Would they be allowed to cross state lines to seek shelter with family? Whether or not the stadium is still going to be the place, whether or not hotels will be open and accepting people. I think that's one very concrete area where I see a shortcoming, which I really think is very, very important at this time.
So, Jeff, what about you? Is there a convening to be done of, are there other places like NCDP? I know I'm on the new, I'm on the UN Disaster Risk Reduction author. I'm a lead author for their next big report on the global assessment report on, I'm on the communication part. And I, and we're looking at all these gaps and understanding that are being revealed now. You know, the World Health Organization is about to convene, they're convening, it's ending next week, a meeting on the emerging field of infodemiology. Like, how do we stem the infodemic that's really part of the pandemic? So what's the big need here in the emergency management arena?
Well, I would say that we're building our response to 21st century disasters based on, you know, 20th century models of managing disasters. So I'll sort of give two quick examples. In the US, there are as many as 90 different disaster relief programs that are administered across as many as 20 different agencies. I wrote an op-ed last fall where I said that's 85 agencies and 15 programs too many. Right, that we layer these on one at a time. But then sort of in that same vein, I'm thinking back to Pete Gaynor, the current administrator of FEMA, his confirmation hearing. And I'm not trying to throw shade at the FEMA administrator, but it was a very interesting moment where one of the senators was grilling him about what's the cause of this increase in natural disasters? Is it climate change? And of course, they're trying to back him into a corner to acknowledge climate change. And anyway, he gives this response, and I actually don't blame him for his response, given the political climate that he's working within. But he says, you know, it's not FEMA's job to say what the cause of a disaster is. It's only our job to manage it. And that moment, I think, really illustrated the fundamental problem with how we look at disasters. You cannot have an agency that is only authorized under its authorizing legislation to look at the consequences of disasters or to only look at the built environment and mitigation. You know, economic policy, social policy, education policy, these all set the table for disasters. And again, I'm not trying to throw shade at the individual, but I do think that the fact that was, it's just, you know, we need a wholesale re-looking at our systems that are designed to respond to these disasters to be as comprehensive as the complexities of the disasters that we face. And that's not an easy thing to do, but it's not going to be accomplished by a couple of trainings and some reworking within an agency. It's having to take a look at the portfolio. Sorry, I'm not being long-winded, but just one more thing with the pandemic was that, you know, I was at a convening of the what's now the Bipartisan Commission on Biodefense, and I think a year or 2 years ago, and Ron Klain, the Ebola czar, was there speaking. And I remember him talking about how he hoped that he would be the last infectious disease czar. And the recommendations from the commission and the point that he was making was that we have the responsibilities are distributed across all of these different agencies. State Department has a lot of the global work, DOD with the military assets, HHS, CDC. And I know I'm preaching to the choir of folks on here, right? How do you administer this distributed responsibility that's distributed by statute and then bring it together to work cohesively? And I think to his credit, what Ron Klain did was function as a bureaucrat, as air traffic control, and kept the experts out front. But it's very vulnerable to the whims of the politics of the moment when that's not anchored in legislation, when that's not anchored in the laws of the land. And I think we do have enough information now to essentially repeal and rebuild our disaster frameworks to be more agile in the face of the threats that we face. But it requires a commitment of a level that is at least that of the post 9/11 days and the restructuring and creation of our homeland security apparatus. So, sorry, I went off on quite a bit there.
No. Well, there's a long list of things to do. The other one, of course, one of the things I think you all think about is that the budget imbalance. Like Costa Samaras at Carnegie Mellon, who I've dealt with for many years on climate and innovation, he says budget is policy. And you look at the fire, you look at the U.S. Forest Service. They know, they've done trainings, they've done preparedness, they've done all kinds of projects to try to limit community vulnerability to wildfire. But it's this tiny fraction of a budget that's massively focused on firefighting. And that has its own political sustainability. There's a firefighting, someone said there's a wildfire industrial complex in America, just like there was, you used to think of the other industrial complex. If you Google for that, you'll find it. And that feels like a, if there's one grand challenge, it's also getting some more funding for the basic questions of investing in preparedness. Alice, I don't know whether that's ingrained in the things you think about as a priority too. And we're close to the end. We can go a little longer if you're okay, folks.
Well, I definitely, I agree. Where the money is, that's, people count what we count, and it's money. So that will drive programs. And definitely we need much greater investment in preparedness going forward. If there's a silver lining here, I think that all of us have collectively experienced a catastrophic risk materializing. We've seen exposed the deep vulnerabilities of certain segments of society that we have not had, that those groups have not had sufficient access and preparation for these types of events, and they're on the front lines suffering the most. So we have a lot we've learned that we could apply going forward to have much better outcomes. I also see much more political activism on the need for better outcomes going forward on all the range of risks and systemic problems that we face. So that gives me hope. And for each of us, there's also going to be a responsibility to prepare ourselves and to get to the question we started with. When your neighbor's not prepared, maybe we all need to work better to help our neighbors as well face this, including all of those in our community to come out in a much stronger way.
And Rod, you have the last word.
All right. Well, I would just go back to, you know, the old saying that leadership matters. And, you know, we can develop many kinds of plans and strategies, but they have to be implemented. They have to be recognized. And I agree with all of the other comments that the excellent panel had. I do think that having, because of the way the United States is structured and the enormous amount of power given to the executive, that who runs the national, the executive branch, and to a large degree, the congressional side of the House, really matters. We are watching, unfortunately, an experiment underway in how the United States, in particular this pandemic, we're seeing how other countries have flattened their curve. We are watching how the United States and that up, down, and then rapid increase, I think, is a real reflection of either executive underreach or policy impotence, or something even worse. And, I think we really need to pay attention to that aspect. As a scientist, we oftentimes talk about what good is analysis and what good is data and evidence if it just sits on the table in a book somewhere, and if these plans are not being followed.
That's a really important point. So that means if we have a national disaster review board, it should be a global one so that you can do the cross comparison. And I think that's that idea that we have an experiment underway, it's again, the toll and the losses which we've chronicled here are horrific, which adds to the responsibility I think we all have to make the most of the moment and understand it in the context of what we can do going forward. It's great to have you all with us.
Good to see you again.
Rod Schoonover, Alice Hill, Jeff Schlegelmilch, new director of our National Center for Disaster Preparedness. a worthy successor to Erwin Redliner, who's still at Columbia and doing great work. And I'm Andy Revkin. Little closing boilerplate here. Sustain What, which is what you're watching, is a global online conversation identifying solutions to the complicated, shape-shifting, and epic challenges of today's great acceleration and now the great pause that this virus has enforced upon us. A prime focus is making sense of and getting the most out of the planet's fast-forward information environment. It's the one Earth system changing faster than the actual biogeophysical environment. And that's what's connecting us today. This webcast is produced as part of my work building Columbia University's new Earth Institute initiative on communication and sustainability. As soon as we're done, share the link you're watching on with friends and circles far and wide. Get in touch with ideas. Look at the scrolling bar and you can see how to get in touch with me. And tune in. Friday, we have our regular news review. I'm still putting it together. We're going to talk about herd immunity and the Mississippi governor, who's Republican and did a really smart Twitter thread on herd immunity myths and realities. Sunday is back to music and arts. And Monday, we're doing a session on online harassment, tools for anyone who's become a public communicator and how to fend off the worst of the internet. So again, thanks to my guests and to you for listening. Share this and be well.